中国人民志愿军。2013年的冬天，美国东北部缅因州的老城降下了大雪。清早起床，退伍老兵保罗·马丁清理门前的积雪。
Main snow。
美国中部密西根州只有1000多人的爱德沃斯伯格小镇，这几天也下了雪。退伍老兵查斯特·克莱普早早备好了过冬的木柴，准备过圣诞了。60年前的冬天，韩国冰天雪地，两人都在前线与中朝部队苦战。那场战争早已淡出人们的视线，可每到冬天，门前的积雪会让他们想起白雪覆盖的韩国山峰、河谷与平原，想起雪地里爆炸留下的炭黑和血迹。今天，一个平常很少想起的小岛勾起了新的回忆，那是离釜山不到200英里的巨基岛，联军关押中朝战俘的地方。保罗·马丁当年是美国陆军25师27步兵团的步枪手，这支部队骁勇善战，人称猎狼犬。在1951年4月中下旬开始的第5次战役中是联军的主力，而且抓获了大批志愿军战俘。
Boy, I bet you we captured 9-8 months up in the front lines here. Must have been 1500 maybe, something like that. A lot of them. Some of the Chinese came up with their hands up like this. They knew they were outnumbered, you know. They just gave up. And others, you had to put the gun on them, you know. Come on.
志愿军战俘面对美军显现的惊恐，让马丁很吃惊。他认为那一定是中共宣传的结果。
But they were told by their commanders, the Americans are mean, you know.And the reason they said that was they scared them. They say, well, we don't want to be captured by the Americans because they're going to treat us bad. They might kill us.
克莱普和中国军人的初次接触也是在前线，而且没什么好印象，因为他差点被中国人的炮弹炸死。
He lived in these little sandbag huts. And this was my mortar pit.And either the Chinese or the North Koreans threw 76 round in one time. I had a raincoat. It had been raining. I put that raincoat over the mortar so it wouldn't get wet. And that round come right in, hit direct hit here. And you can pick that raincoat up and look like spaghetti, you know. Just, and big in the back here, I picked.Pieces of shrapnel about that long and that wide, about that thick, sharp on both edges. Boy, it could cut you in half. You know, I was just up there, just probably no more than 5 minutes. I was just up there and put that raincoat on there, and I walked back to go down into the bunker, and boom, boy, it really made it, the whole ground shook, you know. So I made it by 5 minutes.
到1951年底。迅速增加的中朝战俘被送到离釜山不远的巨济岛，由美军宪兵和韩国军人负责警卫。由于人手有限，一些美军下级军官被赋予管理重任。住在芝加哥市区的理查德·罗森布拉特就是职权大于军衔的美军宪兵中尉，因为被他管理的中朝战俘多达2000人。
There were these camps on Koji Island, and they were humongous as far as personnel went. There were 6,000, 7,000 POWs in a camp, in an enclosure that were meant to hold maybe 2,000 or 3,000.
战俘的增加无疑提高了管理的难度，很多人又是第一次管理战俘，难免存在这样或那样的问题。
But looking back after all these years, it was pretty, it was rewarding. It was like being mayor of a city with all those people. But of course, it wasn't very democratic.
但是罗森布拉特最听不得战俘营吃不饱的抱怨。
What I ate wasn't the same as what the POWs ate. POWs ate, they always got squid and rice.And soy sauce, I remember, and they got all, you know, we'd bring in 100 pounds of rice or 200 or 300, and they'd cook it themselves. They had their own cooks and kitchens, and they never complained about that.
没过多久，战俘营中的人民军战俘开始闹事，治安恶化，联军不得不从前线抽调作战部队。增强聚集岛的治安，与中朝战俘的接触从此增多。
Christmas Eve 1951, we'd landed at Kojido. Yeah, Christmas Eve. Oh, that was a lot of bright lights when we get out of there. Nighttime, you know, it was about midnight when we got there. And they had a lot of lights around the compounds there, you know, the prison, the war. They had double barbed wire fences, you know.And when we got off that ship, drove up by those fences, a lot of the prisoners were standing on the fence looking out at us, you know. When we came ashore, it was kind of eerie, you know.
这个使命被很多前线官兵视为美差，调去聚集岛的人也很高兴。可有人很快发现，他们对这项勤务的难度缺乏足够的估计。
Really boring, yes.You had to stand 4 hours. Every 4 hours, on 12 hours, you had to stand 4 hours guard. I was better off on the front lines, I think.
住在伊利诺伊州哥伦比亚市郊区的罗素·布奇勒，当年也是聚集岛上的警卫。这项看似简单的工作，让他不堪重负。
They had us walking 6 hours on and 12 off.Because they were said they had a shortage of men.
与人民军相比，志愿军战俘营就成了典范。由反共人士控制的战俘营，从聚集岛就开始与美军充分合作，出公差、听调遣、吃苦耐劳，美军对此印象深刻。
I had about 10 or 15 Chinese prisoners for 10 days. These Chinese were workers. Them the hardest working men I've ever seen in my life.
尽管语言不通，但布奇勒和中国战俘们相处融洽。
Instead of giving them one cigarette a day, I give them a whole pack in the morning and a whole pack in the afternoon. Oh, they grinned from ear to ear. In fact, I hate to say it, but I got to like them. They did a lot of laughing.So I just laughed with him, and we had a good time.
每天的粪呢，那个粪桶要到海边去倒了，洗干净了，那个粪桶要抬回来。那么美国兵押送，这边我们这些台湾的就，哎，就说咱们唱歌啊，要唱走，跟着毛泽东走啊。这个美国兵也不知道什么意思，他也跟着喊说。跟着毛泽东走啊，要跟着我们一块唱哇！我们心里都可高兴了、啊。我说别的，他们很天真，哎，即使他们知道这个歌曲的意思，他们也无所谓，是不是？
那釜山的美国大夫对我照顾还好。这边是一个中国人，这边一个人，这边是断腿的，这边是露肠子的，大粪都在这旮瘩。那美国大夫伺候呢。他也不嫌臭，他们我都要捂鼻子的，我在厨房当中擦一会，就喷出来，我的害擦，擦会，又喷出来害擦。所以说，美国人图是啥呢？在战场上是谁不让谁，哎，可是到了平常是好人， 大大的好人的美国。
美国人哈，他注重人权。你在战场上，你死了以后，你打伤了，你只要有一口气，他觉得直升机载你走了。Yeah, 韩国人就不行，韩国人他妈他闹不走，他就机枪扫掉你。要不要是这样的？美国人抓到你，他还有吃的，还有香烟呐、啊，口香糖啊，再给你，你吃。
管理当局还调用懂汉语的美军人员介入战俘管理。中国战俘熟知的布鲁克斯上尉就是典型，也是韩战中的传奇人物。布鲁克斯父亲是传教士，母亲是中国人。1946年，布鲁克斯中尉跟随马歇尔将军赴华，结识了云南女子李美华，两人结婚，一年后生下小威利。布鲁克斯后来患上了黄疸病，不得不回美国治疗。1949年，国民党溃败，美华携子随李弥将军的部队撤退，途中被中共俘获，从此下落不明。韩战爆发后，在台湾独居的布鲁克斯重新被美军征召，专门从事志愿军战俘的审讯和情报搜集。他汉语流利，熟知中国文化，很受欢迎，让亲共战俘都感到亲切，并与他合影留念。无论是前线还是釜山，以及后来的巨济岛和济州岛，只要有中国战俘的地方，就会出现布鲁克斯那硕大的身影。詹姆斯·巴德是美国军队中少有的会讲中文的人，他父亲是一位在中国生活多年的美国传教士，巴德本人就出生在中国，
张家口出生的。我是中国人，不是吗？你看不见吗？
巴德在中国长到14岁，随父母回到美国。大学一年级那年，杜鲁门总统的一纸征兵令把他招入军中，派到日本。一天在军中食堂，他正和一位同样在中国出生的日裔美军边吃边聊，碰巧被旁边的一位上校听到了。
And he says, Soldier? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I says, colonels are very big people. I was a little private. So he says, what's the deal? You're not speaking Japanese, are you? Oh, no, sir. No, I'm speaking Chinese with him. My friend here was born in China, and I was born in China, so we speak in Chinese. Oh, is that right? I would like to see you in my office when you're through.In your earliest convenience, like in the next 5 or 10 minutes. 3 days later, I was an interrogator in Korea.
1952年夏天，巴德被派往韩国釜山审讯志愿军战俘。不过在他看来，与其说审讯，自己更多的是在做些安抚工作。
He's very, very fearful.He's been told Americans eat Chinese. Of course, Americans eat Chinese, but they never told them food. You know, so...
They left out that part.
They left out that part. So, he thinks we're going to munch on him. I don't think so.
You're telling me Americans are not eating Chinese.
That's right. We're not going to eat you. Don't worry about it. You're going to be okay.
So, tell me, what's the normal procedure?
Normal procedure? 你好吗？怎么样？你累了吗？Or, 你吃饭了没有？ And then it was a conversation. Initially, most were fearful of what was going to happen to them. One of the things I always said, 不要害怕。没有关系，我们不给你，
不打你，不给你。
Yeah, you know, 我是你的朋友，你要什么你就告诉我，我你可以用啊，我就找了。你要吃什么饭？你有病你告诉我，我帮你。And really in a strange environment, and being moved from here to there by people he doesn't know who have bayonets on their weapons and yelling at them and pushing them here and pushing them there, they finally come to a guy that looks like the rest of them, but he's speaking in Chinese to him. Man, half the prisoners, especially the farmer kids and so on like that,fell in love with me, you know, they appreciated 谢谢你谢谢你 was a common response, right? Says, go with this man and he'll give you some, he'll take you to the mess hall and get your place to stay.
另一位具有传奇色彩的美国人就是职业外交官菲利普·曼哈特，他在北平学的中文。1949年，他是天津美国领事馆的政治官员，一直留任到共产党接管的1950年。这一对2014年在纽约以$54万拍出的明代黄花梨太师椅，就是他在那兵荒马乱的时期从撤退的政府要员手中买下的，然后几经辗转运回美国。1951年，菲利普出任釜山美国领事馆的外交官。战俘营的中国战俘迅速增加后，曼哈特操着流利的北平话，以记者的身份到各个战俘营，专门找亲共战俘的军官们交谈，并向声称遭受不公平待遇的战俘提供帮助。聚集到72战俘营140多名亲共战俘转移到对面的71战俘营，就与他的介入有很大的关系。在不少战俘的回忆录或文章中，菲利普是个经常被提到的美国人，他也被怀疑为是中央情报局的特工。理由很简单，菲利普对中共意识形态很有研究，而且中文过于流利。1968年，在南越担任顾问的菲利普被越共俘虏，坐了几年监牢。1973年获释后，尼克松总统次年任命菲利普为美国驻毛里求斯大使。1952年，20000中国战俘被送达济州岛后，14000名反共人士充分配合管理，赢得了美军的信任。退役上尉弗莱德·克罗纳杰是济州岛反共战俘营的美军负责人，负责500名中国战俘。他回忆，美军负责人只在上午进入营区与战俘大队长进行管理交接，双方开始密切合作。
Okay, that's me on the left, my interpreter. The one next to me there was really an officer, which he shouldn't have been in there. But he didn't work, and I asked him one day, I said, why don't he work? And then they told me he was an officer.But not to tell anybody because they'd have taken him out of there. But he was real nice and he kept control of the people too. He was very nice.
美军同时注重战俘营中的特殊人才使用。退役老兵万斯·沃克尔住在田纳西州的克利夫兰，附近大城市是印第安味道十足的查塔努加。那里山峦起伏，视野开阔。公路限速75英里，沃克尔平时枪不离身，短发黑衣，侠气十足。他称自己1952年11月被派到济州岛，专门看管中国军官战俘。这份美军文件显示，15名会英语的中国战俘自愿为美军提供了文件翻译服务和英文的情况汇报。
I guess it may be 25 officers. I don't know what the rank was because they didn't, you know, what the majors, whatever it was, but they all spoke English. I said, what'd you learn English? University of California. So how'd you get in the Chinese Army? They got drafted. So they got drafted, they went back to China.
弗莱德·克罗纳杰平时喜欢摄影。到东京休假时，自己掏腰包购买了颇为时髦的8毫米摄影机和胶片， 忠实记录了穆瑟普战俘营生活的方方面面。500中国战俘的充分合作让他十分满意，他也网开一面，为战俘们提供了很多方便。
They grew vegetables, grew some potatoes, things like that. Volcanic soil is good, rich soil. Yes, so they had pretty good gardens, and they produced quite a bit of food that way. Got those from some of the local people, and they got them as little piglets, and then they raised them, and eventually they ate them.
克罗纳杰的家在佛罗里达西岸美丽的海滨，后院有私人码头。他经常注视挂在墙上的山房山手绘图，回忆在山脚下度过的日日夜夜。那是济州岛西南端的重要地标，也是战俘们通往海边的必经之路。他经常善待中国人，有时为此还故意把出公差的时间挪后。
Sometimes we'd go out in the afternoon and not get back till midnight. So I always saw to it if we got back that late that they had an extra meal.
常年战乱，山房山下的村庄有的只剩下女性。韩战开始后，有人靠山吃山，操起皮肉生意。一次公差结束返回，为了犒劳辛苦一天的中国人，克罗纳杰提议带他们到村里寻欢，由他付钱。战俘们谢绝了他的好意，理由是怕染病。战俘们在艰苦的环境中依然洁身自好，让克罗纳杰记忆犹新。美军看守沃克尔回忆，也有中国战俘把地道挖到女战俘营，在那里刷夜。我们无法证实他的叙述，但如果属实，的确展示了战俘生活的另一种真实。
I'll tell you something else. The women prisoners kept getting pregnant. And they want, well, they dug tunnels under the compound to get to the ladies' prison. They wondered how they were getting pregnant. And the guys were digging tunnels under the ground.
Who?
The Chinese prisoners were.
美国军人在个人层面上的平等意识，使得战俘营的管理相对宽松。
I tried to not be over above them and look down on them. I tried to look straight at them and keep them on the same level as me. Now, if we'd have met 6 months before, we'd have tried to kill each other. But that, those days were gone because the prisoners were there and I was there and we had to get along. We had to work together and that's what we did. We worked together and it was to their advantage.And naturally, my advantage that they didn't give me any trouble, and I didn't give them any trouble.
相对宽松的气氛是以战俘的合作为基础的，并不代表战俘营管理松懈。
I happened to be on guard duty, and I saw this captain walk into the compound and face the POW commander and just really slapped him straight across the face. For what reason, I don't know.
就是在克罗纳杰领导的战俘营也有闹事分子，让克罗纳杰险些丢了性命。
One time, we were going out on a detail to work in the gardens, and I was standing at the gate with the leaders of the compound, plus my interpreters. And somebody came up behind me with a shovel and tried to hit me with a shovel. And one of the officers there pushed me, knocked me down. And I got up, I looked around, and I didn't see him. I didn't see who did it, but they'd hauled him away someplace. And I don't know, I think I know what happened, but I'm not sure. But anyhow, that was the only incident I ever had.
转眼到了1953年春天，科罗纳杰的任期已满，就要回国了。战俘们听说后十分惋惜，与科罗纳杰朝夕相处的翻译李英军亲手缝制了这面精致的刺绣，与老长官告别。其他战俘也各显神通，罐头盒变成了铁皮坦克，各种军用物资的礼品和绣品都刻上了科罗纳杰的名字。韩战60周年时，科罗纳杰应韩国政府邀请前往首尔，向当地的韩战博物馆捐献了战俘们送给他的手工礼品。这些珍贵的绣品没舍得捐，又拿了回来。
My kids, because they don't mean anything to them.
战俘营表面一片祥和，却有人不断神秘失踪。原来联军已开始从战俘营挑选可靠的战俘为联军担任情报员，目标瞄准反共立场十分坚定的志愿军战俘，多以前国军人员，尤其是黄埔军校的学生为主。
上一个救护车，也十字车，那都晚上完了，到了一个地方之后啊，到了就是美军那个，就所谓这个单位的办事处吧，他一个一个问话。我们那时候去是30多个人，我记得是30多个人，他留下来是只是30个。他说我知道你是反共的，你是希望到台湾。他现在说联合国假如给你个任务，给你个任务，然后呢你就可以去台湾，你愿不愿意做？这话是废话，我当然愿意嘛。
高文俊等人被秘密送到仁川外海的仙甲岛接受训练，美军同时将他们除名。这两份文件显示，仅1953年2月就有40名中国战俘从釜山美军第14野战医院逃亡。高文俊的逃亡时间是2月27号。训练结束后，这些人被补充到美军8240特种部队，接受战术联络任务，主要是化妆成志愿军陆地穿越，重返北方进行侦察。
虽然战线就是我们的这个，我那这因为年龄问题不只能当兵嘛，我那22岁啊，那不你不你哪能共产党没那么干，共产党干部都要30岁真的。所以那不像嘛，就我就当兵，就背个那个转盘冲锋枪，带着那个这个草编的干粮这样的，那个手榴弹，带4个手榴弹。这个老美这个东西啊，真厉害。那花钱就像共产党兵一样，跟走当兵，他分不出来的。那干部就是背有配的望远镜、自卫针，就背个那个一个皮匣子什么装几张地图的，带个手枪，就这样的。我们那时候就是说，我是化妆兵，另外是两个干部，还一个就是那个算什么班长一类的这种情形。那个干部就是化妆，就是说这个搜索参谋、侦察参谋做侦察的，因为在北韩只有做侦察的人员呢可以随便行动。
这项原本秘密进行的使命，因一次意外而曝光。1952年2月19日，一架美军 C-46 型军用运输机从日本飞抵朝鲜北部上空实施空投。高文俊的黄埔军校同学张文荣在跃出机舱的一瞬间，把一枚手雷丢回机舱。几秒钟后，飞机在空中爆炸。
In 1952, I had 3 planes out to make drops. I flew one of them up to the Yalu River. And the other one was this plane, the C-46. And Master Sergeant Harrison was the senior jump master, and Corporal Tatarakis was his assistant jump master. Now the other question, was he a double agent, or did he have a change of heart at the last minute as he left that plane and threw the grenade back in it? I can't answer that question. I don't know. Again, I don't know what his motivation was.
住在华盛顿郊外马里兰州乡间的迪拉尔德，退役时是美军特种部队的上校，他是二战、韩战和越战的三战元老。韩战时的军用吉普车依然停在车房，而且能开。他没在战俘营干过，而是美军8240特种部队负责空投的指挥官，曾把多名中国战俘空投到朝鲜与中国东北。他对大多数中国情报员执行的地面穿越任务也相当了解。
I met a Marine some time ago when we were talking about my Korean operation. He said I had the great respect for the agents because over when the Marines were with the 10th Corps over on the East Coast, he said I saw an agent.That came to the line there, and he stepped on a mine, and it blew his leg off. And we could not go to him because of the minefield, and he sat there, and we watched him bleed to death. So I think that is a good example of the danger involved with these. Plus, maybe just being shot by our forces, or by the Chinese or North Koreans, or being picked up later by their security force and tortured or whatever they would do to them. And if they're lucky, they ended up in prison camp rather than being tortured and killed. And they remember they got to make two trips. They have to go in, infiltrate into the target area and cover it, and then exfiltrate back out. So they're going through very dangerous areas twice.
这期间板门店谈判因战俘遣返问题而陷入僵局。为了打破僵局，双方希望在战场上争取主动，提升自己的谈判地位。1952年10月，济州岛升旗事件没过几天，美军发动了摊牌行动，对志愿军前线阵地三角峰发动攻击。战斗打了42天，双方伤亡30000人。美军伤亡1500人，志愿军15军45师遭到毁灭性打击，这就是著名的上甘岭战役。
就是这个每一平方公尺上要落下2个炮弹，整个的表面阵地上几乎没有人的生存条件。我看见过一个字。朝鲜战争一结束，我就到志愿军总部去看我们的展览，专门从上甘岭取了一平方土30公分厚，这块土全是被硝烟熏成像黑炭一样，有2300多块弹片，还有人骨头、破衣服、破的木屑，几乎仅仅一平方米，就像这个桌这么大一点，你可想而知。
双方寸土必争，美军也代价沉重。1953年2月13日，美军排长奥卡拉汉中士率兵攻上一个布满志愿军尸体的阵地。只有一个小兵对着步话机在大喊大叫，奥卡拉汉下令抓活的，没等抓住小兵，志愿军的炮弹就飞了过来，全排士兵除3人外全部被炸死，奥卡拉汉失去了左腿。
共军阵地上都是一片死尸伤亡的，只有一个小兵还活着，但是他没拿武器。这卡拉汉他说了，咱们
咱们把他抓活的，也是，出了他跟前，看到他手里有一个爆发机话筒，他在喊什么？卡拉汉又不懂他，他讲的喊的什么？喊着喊着，炮弹来了，把他100多美国兵全部炸死了，就活下来三个都残废了。这个卡拉汉说，他说我从那以后，我对中国人特别恨，他说我们当时不打死你，这个哪知道你掉炮弹把我们100多人全给都给炸死了，这个你这个中国就不遵守战争游戏规则，你这个中国人不讲理。
奥卡拉汉1970年当选内华达州州长，四年后并高票连任。2004年去世前，奥卡拉汉对中国士兵甘愿牺牲个人生命守卫阵地的举动表示尊重和理解。
因为我是最早写这个向我开炮的，他就找到我，把这个内华达州的那个副州长叫罗伯特也领了带到北京来，和那个卡拉汉的女儿也带到北京来跟我见面。见面他女儿到北京来的时候，一定要我带着我的孩子跟他认识一下，我就带我的儿子跟他见面了。他见到我儿子就说，咱们的父辈在战场上见面都是互相打的，从我们这一代起应该互相做朋友，应该互相交流，互相理解，互相尊重。
韩战的僵局让美国朝野陷入焦虑，民间反战呼声提高。1952年当选美国总统的二战盟军统帅艾森豪威尔兑现竞选承诺，当选一个月就视察了韩战前线。他深入前沿，在阵地上与美军官兵们进行交流。他在回国途中表示，我们无法容忍朝鲜半岛的冲突继续下去。1953年3月，斯大林突然去世，和谈出现转机。4月初，中朝明确表示就战俘问题继续谈判。已经就职的艾森豪威尔指示联军总司令克拉克加快战俘谈判，首先交换伤兵战俘的提议很快由美方提了出来，得到了中朝方面的积极回应。
1953年3月份，斯大林突然死了，然后这情况才扭转，苏联人不想再打了，这时候然后才实现了这个伤病战俘的交换。然后到了七月份停战协议达成，然后这些愿意回国的战俘才交换，所以战争至少说可以说是多打了一年半，就是完全是因为这个战俘谈不下来。但这当初是谁也没有预料到的，就是毛泽东斯大林一直都非常乐观，他觉得敌人怎么可能为了这些中国的战俘来坚持战争。像这个时候北朝鲜人金日成已经不想再打了，到了1952年初的时候他很明显他不想再打了，他说他知道这再打也不可能去解放南朝鲜，他干脆不要打。
既然苏联和朝鲜都不愿意再打下去了，毛泽东也不好继续坚持，只好同意恢复谈判。3月30日，中国政府发表声明，建议双方在停战后立即遣返自愿回国的战俘，而将拒绝遣返的战俘转交中立国等候公正解决。联军方面和中朝方面于1953年4月26日恢复谈判，并就美国提出的伤病战俘遣返达成一致。6月8日，中共代表正式接受美方提出的志愿遣返原则，双方当天签署了交换战俘协定，为达成停战协定扫清了道路。与此同时，艾森豪威尔总统不顾内阁成员的反对，明确表示愿意接受朝鲜半岛割据状态下的停火。 艾森豪威尔4月16日在华盛顿发表和平的机会讲话，呼吁朝鲜半岛实现和平。讲话以后，韩战的谈判进程明显加快，双方4月20日开始在板门店交换伤残战俘，1030名志愿军人员被送回中国。台湾方面加紧努力，争取所有反共战俘前往台湾。国民党中央秘密派遣负责大陆策反工作的第6组副组长陈建忠，1953年春以中华民国副武官的身份前往汉城使馆开展协调，并直接与反共战俘沟通。陈建忠长期介入策反中共的工作，与习近平的父亲习仲勋早年关系密切。6月8日，双方签署战俘交换协议。一直不愿停火的李承晚不顾美方的警告，退出停战谈判。6月18日，又突然释放20000多名不愿遣返的朝鲜战俘，对协议表示抗议，这让部分中国战俘有了可乘之机。
釜山的这个华籍战俘呢，就集体逃出，107个人逃出来啊，有50个还是被美军劫回去了，只剩下57个。然后后面又陆续又逃出6个，他们说因为人地生疏，语言不通，被韩国警察拘留。但是我们这个外交部呢，就训令韩国大使馆跟韩方接洽，然后结果南韩政府呢，就根据双方共同的反共立场，所以就予以保护这些人，然后。韩方就是照着这样做，这个外交部呢不断的接触，然后保障他的安全，然后后来设法把他们接回来。这是中华民国政府跟南韩政府合作的一个结果。
这65名战俘后来被送到台北松山机场，成为首批抵达台湾的反共义士，受到台湾各界的热烈欢迎，在国际社会引起轰动，宣传效应十分强烈。韩国释放战俘的消息立即传到济州岛，美军文件显示，第3战俘营第2联队4931名战俘，6月20日和21日示威2天，他们高举标语，挥舞旗帜，拒绝前往板门店，并反对印度、波兰和捷克斯洛伐克充当中立国，他们要求像北韩战俘一样获得释放。几10名战俘爬上营房顶部示威，导致铁皮屋顶坍塌，12人落地受伤。美军要求停止示威，遭到拒绝，和韩国士兵一道持枪进入示威规模最大的第7分营，从北面释放催泪瓦斯，战俘被迫进入室内躲避。美军采用对付巨济岛北韩战俘同样的方式，向战俘室内投掷多枚催泪弹，强迫505名战俘撤到教场上。美军将室内的标语旗帜全部收缴，同时命令5分营的500名战俘撤到教场，命令立即得到执行。韩国的突然举动让联军措手不及，原定6月27日签订的停战协议被拖延。美国高层警告李承晚，如果继续干扰停战进程，美国将停止对韩国政府的支持，并撤出朝鲜半岛。1953年7月27日，联军与中朝代表在韩国缺席的情况下，在板门店签署停战协定。当天夜里，朝鲜大地轰鸣了3年的炮火突然平息，出现了少有的平静。这对听惯了隆隆炮声的两国军人来说是那样的反常。天一蒙蒙亮，志愿军官兵们小心地钻出坑道，首次在山顶挺直了腰身。他们抽起了烟卷，警惕地注视着四周的宁静，希望和平真的已经降临。美军却已经开始庆祝了。志愿军战地记者卢红此时正在38线实验洞北山阵地前沿，他和几名战友大胆地接近中间地带的美军，相互问候。 并撕下笔记本中的一张插画，递给对面一名年仅18岁的美国兵，留作纪念。
我送给他这一张画以后，那个小兵啊，他想还礼，也给我个纪念品。他身上到处说没什么东西也没有，他就摸出一张钞票，摸出这一张钞票。
这是韩国票？
不，实际上是美军的军用币。
哦，军用。
他是随军
带、
随军的，他美国
军用
本土不能用的，他是军队的能用。
啊，
这个上边啊有他写的字。因为60多年过去了，这个字就消失了。
天越来越亮了，一夜没睡的美军和志愿军官兵依然沉浸在兴奋和警觉之中。他们担心眼前的平静会不会像以往那样短暂。山顶被炮弹削平的树干不断提示着战争的残酷。炮击会再次开始吗？真的能和平吗？远离38线的济州岛，20000多名中国战俘的眼睛同时默默地注视着北方的天际，希望传来停战的消息。他们的命运能因此出现转机吗？请继续收看《美国之音》系列纪录片《志愿军战俘》。Never smile on me.